Hello everybody, welcome to this introductory lesson on short circuit withstand of power cables. The scope is to make all of us in approximately half an hour, 40 minutes, able to understand all the main issues of interest in case of short circuit and to evaluate the stresses on power cables in case of short circuit. And finally, to properly size, protect, and install a power cable to withstand a short circuit. For doing this, we need some introduction and some basics. As usual, or better, when it's possible, let's start with the official definition from the International Electrotechnical Vocabulary. A short circuit is an accidental or a deliberate connection across a comparatively low resistance or low impedance between two or more points of a circuit, which usually have a different voltage. A short circuit current is a current flowing through the short circuit. Today, we want to evaluate which kind of stresses this current causes on power cables. The first basic question to be answered is why do we have to do this? That is, why do we have to take into account short circuit in studying our cables and in sizing protections and cable. The answer is quite obvious. The current in the full electrical installation and then in cables too during short circuit is the maximum current allowed in the specific electrical installation. So we have to evaluate the maximum, the extreme stresses on cables caused by this large current. This picture is from GE Industrial Power System data book. It's quite old, but quite representative in my opinion. Also because it shows that the short circuit condition is a condition of fault. The short circuit current is indeed an overcurrent, but it's not overload, because overcurrent related to overload are current in a non-faulted installation. The overcurrent because of short circuit is an overcurrent in a faulted installation. Let's start with the main types of short circuit. The main types of short circuit can be classified on the basis of the number of phases involved in the short circuit. So we have a three-phase short circuit, phase-to-phase, phase-to-phase-to-earth, and phase-to-earth. The first one, that is the three-phase short circuit, is balanced, and we don't need to distinguish between three-phase and three-phase-to-earth, simply because it's balanced, it's a balanced condition. All the other type of short circuit are unbalanced. And this is another classification of a short circuit. The main characteristics of the short circuit is, in this chapter we could put a lot of issues. I decided to put just a few of them. That is, we have to distinguish between a bolted fault and an arcing fault. Bolted fault is characterized by the phases bolted together to create a zero impedance connection. Typically, in calculation, we refer to this situation. But in reality, we also have arcing fault, that is an arc fault occur when loose or corroded connections make intermittent contact and causes sparking or arcing between the connection. Is indeed of interest in the reality, but not used typically for calculation, or better, it is to be referred just for quite specific calculation. Today we will not mention it anymore. This is a quite spectacular picture I found on the web, and this is an example of arcing. This is not a cable but overhead line between, by the way, a short circuit caused by an electric arc. Other characteristics to be taken into account about a short circuit are the duration, the origin, and the location. About duration, the first situation is the short circuit is self-extinguishing or not. For example, in air, this is a possibility, but also in some other situation. The short circuit can be transient or steady state. The origin of the short circuit can be mechanical. I always remember my teacher that mentioned me, the technicians that left some tool inside the large electrical machinery. The tool was metallic, and this is a quite singular but also typical situation of a short circuit. Quite recently I experimented something similar with an error left inside a large electrical machinery. Another situation is another cause, another origin of short circuit is related to overvoltages, internal or external, that is atmospheric overvoltages. Or also there is the possibility to have an insulation breakdown due to heat, to humidity, or to corrosive environment, or also pollution on the surface of some insulation. The location, the short circuit can be inside or outside a machine or an electrical switchboard. The consequences of a short circuit. Indeed, these are the real reason for which we have to take into account a short circuit, and we want to protect our cable against them. We have consequences at least in three places. Where the fault is located, on the faulty circuit, but also on the other circuit nearby the faulted one. A bit more in detail on the at the fault location. In this location, indeed, we will experiment a damage of the insulation. We can find the conductors welded. There is the risk of fire with all the other consequences related to life and property, risk for life and properties, and we can have electrical arcs. On the faulty circuit, we have two main consequences. The mechanical forces related to the magnetic field, the interference between the magnetic field and the very large short circuit current, and an excessive temperature rise on our equipment and our cables. To today. On the other circuit nearby the faulted one, we will experiment voltage dips, and on this we have a specific lesson. We can experiment the shutdown of a part of the network. We can have a dynamic instability as well as disturbances on control and monitoring circuit. This is another picture. Don't worry because unfortunately I have not been able to find other pictures to be put in this presentation. This is a cable, rubber extruded cable involved in a fire caused by a short circuit, and the consequences are quite evident in South Italy. The determinants of the short circuit current, that is, the parameters, the characteristics of the electrical installation, we have to consider, we have to take into account for short circuit evaluation. The short circuit current depends mainly on the following factors. The voltage level, and not only the voltage level of the network, but also the actual operating voltage on the network. Typically, we have a tolerance of 10% on the voltage, short circuit calculation are to be referred to 110% of the rated voltage, if nothing other is specified. The neutral condition, that is, the system is TT, TN, or IT. The impedance of the system between any generation unit. The short circuit location. The impedance of the short circuit, as we already said, this impedance is very low, can be more or less zero or not. Usually we refer to zero impedance and bolted short circuit, or number of generation units in the system. Quite often for low voltage installation, we represent, we condense all these determinants in one single parameter, that is the short circuit power in the level in which I wanted to study my short circuit. But this is just a summary, valid in some situation, but not valid in other situation, of the list of determinants we have in the slide now. Determinant of the short circuit current to be considered is the distance from generators. Let's start from the simplest case, that is, the shortest circuit is far from the generator. In this case, the AC component of the short circuit current remains constant throughout the total time duration of the short circuit. This is because the influence of the changing reactance of generators can be neglected, or better, the short circuit impedance is a series of some reactance, for example, the reactance of the lines, of the cable lines, the reactance of the transformer, and indeed the reactance of the generator. While the first reactance are a constant, the reactance of a synchronous generator is not a constant, but can vary a lot with the current. So if we are close to the generator, we cannot neglect this variation because the reactance of the generator accounts for a large percentage of the total short circuit reactance. and then I have to perform a calculation taking into account also the variation of this parameter. The parameters of the short circuit current, that is, what are the synthetic parameter I have to know, I have to take into account to make some evaluation about a short circuit. I tried to summarize them in four parameters. Indeed, we should have to add some other. It depends on the level of our analysis. By the way, we have to consider the initial symmetrical short circuit current, EK2. The current EK2 is the root mean square value of the short circuit current at the initial symmetrical short circuit. In case of short circuit far from generator, sinusoidal current EK2 is almost constant during default. This is not valid for short circuit close to generator. The peak short circuit current, IP, does not need any definition, is the peak of the current, but we can add some comment. That is, depending on the feeding source of the short circuit, different consideration can be taken to calculate the peak current. Short circuit in low voltage system normally are single fed short circuit, and this affect this value. A periodic component EDC, that is, I have a transient, each time I have a short circuit, and so the solution of this circuit is practically the superimposition of an exponential current, usually called a periodic component or decaying component, probably because to mention an exponential function is too much mathematics and not enough for engineer. This is quite simple. We just have to remember the theory of circuit, of electrical circuit. This periodic component is the value between the top and the bottom envelope of the short circuit current, decaying from the initial value to zero. The steady state short circuit current IK. This short circuit in a low voltage system usually far from generator is identical to the initial symmetrical short circuit current. If this hypothesis is not fulfilled, EK is not equal to EK second. So four main parameters, but this is not enough because all of them refer to a situation in which we don't have any protection, but in reality we have a circuit protected with some switch gear or some fuse, and so we have to take into account, we have to introduce some other parameter. The first one is the total time duration, that is, the short circuit is not forever, fortunately, but it is stopped, it is ended by the protection. The total time duration of the short circuit current consists of the operating time of the protection devices and the total breaking time of the switch gear. In this picture, you can see it on the bottom, and it is called the total time. This picture refers to a fuse. That is, the peak current of the short circuit is just theoretical, and because the fuse intervene before this peak. The other value to be taken into account is the short circuit breaking current. That is the root mean square value of the short circuit current at the switching instant. That is at the time of operating the circuit breaker, or the fuse. Altogether, these two parameters, that is the current and the time, provide the thermal effect of the short circuit. This is one second order parameter, but very important for us because more synthetic and more related on one important effect of short circuit on our cable and other components, that is the thermal effect. From another point of view, we can classify short circuit current in two main classes, symmetrical and asymmetrical. In symmetrical current, the envelopes of the peaks are symmetrical around the zero axis, and for asymmetrical, the envelopes of the peaks are not symmetrical around the zero axis. These to be taken into account, but a bit mathematical. Minimum and maximum short circuit current. This distinction is very important for cable, less important for other electrical equipment. Why? Because typically a cable is quite long, and so in case of fault at the beginning of the line or at the end of the line, I can have two completely different short circuit current, simply because in the case of the end of the line, I will add to the impedance of the equivalent circuit also the impedance of the line. And if the line is quite long, this cannot be neglected. So we have to consider two different short two circuit current, the maximum short circuit current and the minimum one, that is the one at the end of the line. We need also the minimum short circuit current because this is important for the design of the protection system and the minimal setting of protection relays. Why? Simply because we mentioned that short circuit is overcurrent but not overload. So in any case, I have to recognize this situation, and I don't have to confuse a short circuit current, a small short circuit current, for an overload. I have to trip instantaneously or as soon as possible in case of short circuit, while in case of overload, this is not necessarily requested. Let's move to the maximum short circuit current, because to the maximum short circuit current are related the main aspect of short circuit. Indeed, this is important again for a good sizing of the protection. That is important to size the braking capacity of the circuit breakers and also the making capacity of circuit breakers. Typically, no risk don't recognize this kind of short circuit because the short circuit current is very, very high. Sometimes in low voltage installation, in case of very, very limited short circuit power, there is the risk to have a short circuit current not so different from the rated current of the circuit, but this is quite rare, and indeed this issue will be reduced in the future. So the maximum short circuit current with reference to cable is to be used to determine and to face the thermal stresses on the cable and the mechanical withstand capacity of the cable. So in the next 10 minutes we will refer to the maximum short circuit current, even if we will never mention it anymore. Let's start with the thermal stresses on our cables. Thermal stresses, to face thermal stresses, we need a short circuit thermal rating of the cable. This is required to determine the cross-sectional areas of the conductor and the screen with reference to the short circuit thermal stress. Pay attention, we will come back on this concept, that if the cable is screened, this value is to be taken into account not just for the conductor but also for the screen, because as you can see in this picture, in some short circuit conditions, I can have the short circuit flowing also through the screen or the armor. I mentioned just the screen, but this consideration applies perfectly also for the armor. The short circuit current flows also through the screen or the armor of our cable. How to perform this short circuit thermal rating? We have to compare two quantities. The first one is related to the cable itself and the protection, and it is called ITHZ. That is the short circuit capacity of the conductor. The second one is the thermal equivalent short circuit current, ITH. Indeed, if the cable has to withstand the short circuit thermal stress, ITHZ is to be greater or equal to ITH, that is the thermally equivalent short circuit current. So the scope is to calculate, to evaluate these two quantities. One related to the stresses on the left in this flowchart, and the other one related just to the cable and its protection. Let's start from the left. The parameter I can use to start can be different. This can be the breaking power of the protection, or can be also the initial symmetrical short circuit power. In both cases I have to calculate on the basis of the power the current, the short circuit current, initially in terms of symmetrical breaking current or initial symmetrical short circuit current. Indeed, I also need the short circuit duration, TK. Short circuit duration is requested, is requested indeed to evaluate the thermal effect, but is provided by the protection. With these two parameters, I have to distinguish if my short circuit is far from the generator or near to the generator. If the short circuit is far from generator, no problem. The EK second and IK are exactly equal to IA. Otherwise, I have to take into account the variation of the short circuit impedance because of the generator. We will show this calculation in a few seconds. In any case, my thermally equivalent short circuit current, that is the one I need, is to be calculated on the basis on IK second, multiply by a factor to take into account the effects we mentioned. This this factor is represented in this flowchart as the root square of m plus n. Is simply an engineering approach to simplify this very complicated mathematical problem. M and n are two factors to take into account that the actual short circuit current contains a decreasing direct current component, we already mentioned, and an alternating current component, different if the short circuit is far or close to the generator. This is a graph useful to evaluate M. You have the short circuit duration on the horizontal axis, and you have M on the vertical axis. We have more than one curve to be selected, but frankly, as is typically done when the uncertainty of the reality is very high and the calculation is very difficult, typically we have to refer to the curve characterized by key equal 1.8. And this is more or less the reality for the 99.9% of situation. If we have to perform this calculation in something very, very special, we could have to calculate the key and then the other numbers. The other factor N can be evaluated from this chart. Again, on the horizontal axis, we have the short circuit duration, and N is on the vertical axis. In this case, I have to select the right curve on the basis of the ratio between EK second and EK, as shown in the upper right part. If I evaluated with the previous equation these two parameter I can select easily my curve. Again, not in 99% of situation, but for example in low voltage installation, these two quantities, EK second and EK, are equal, and so the ratio is one, and so I have to refer to the first line on the top, that is, for example, N is exactly equal to one. The other quantity to be compared with ITH is the short circuit capacity of the conductor. This means that we have to calculate this quantity in which A is the nominal cross-section area of the conductor. J is the rated short time current density defined for a rated short circuit duration of 1 second. And the root square is between 1 second and the short circuit duration. Great. So we are able to calculate these two quantities, and we are able to evaluate if a specific cable is able to withstand or not the thermal stresses related to the short circuit. Typically, this process is to be faced with something iterative. This is to be done, as we already mentioned, for the conductor themselves, as well as for metal sheets, screens, and armor. In this slide, we have two pictures. The first one is related to a long-tort short circuit in a three-core cable with common screen. You can see that the short circuit current flow also through the metal sheet, the armor, or the screen. In the second situation, we have a double earth fault in a three-screened single-core cables in an insulated network. In both the cases, the short circuit current flow through the screens. How to calculate the percentage of the short circuit current in the conductor and in the screen? I simply have to know the impedance of each individual current path, and I have to work with a very simple current divider. Pay attention that the impedance to be taken into account is the zero sequence impedance and not necessarily the direct or inverse sequence or indirect sequence impedance. Indeed, we can repeat all the consideration we done for the main conductor. Let's move to the mechanical stresses. Mechanical stresses are from two origins, thermomechanical stresses and electrodynamic mechanical stresses. Thermomechanical stresses, due to the high temperature rise during the short circuit, we have an important expansion of the conductor. This can generate some deflection of the conductor if allowed, or some forces on the conductor or on the insulation if the deflection is not allowed. With these two equations, we can evaluate the longitudinal expansion of a cable with length L. The factor alpha is different for aluminium and copper, and subject to an increase of temperature equal to delta theta. On the bottom of this slide, we have exactly the same, but with reference to the radial expansion, here called delta H. Great. If my cable is not able to move, indeed this expansion can create a forces. These forces are dependent under the condition indeed of the temperature rise. The progression of these forces depend on the material used. We already mentioned copper and aluminium. They depend on the shape of the conductor and the construction of the cable. This is also affected by, let's say, some second order issues like the type of the cable, the method of fixing, the adhesion of the insulation of inside the cable. By the way, how to face this issue? Practically, we have to allow the cable to move in two directions, radial direction and longitudinal direction. The longitudinal expansion, indeed, if the cable is homogeneous, is equally divided over the full length. So for multi-core cables, we have to foresee an overlong straight runs. We have to arrange the cable in a wavy line, and we have to adopt fixation to leave a free loop. For single core cable is similar. Long straight runs in a wavy line, fixed to support, and larger distances between lines to allow deflections. It's mechanical forces means exactly mechanical solutions. Electromagnetic stresses. These are again issues related to mechanical stresses, but in such case the mechanical stresses derive from the interaction between the magnetic field and the current into the conductor. Current in conductor laying side by side produce electromagnetic forces between the conductors as shown now in the slide. Opposite direction current produce a repulsion force, same direction current produce an attractive force. This involve also some forces that tend to turn the cables on themselves. The basic equation to calculate these forces is from the basic of electromagnetic world, and it's this one. You can recognize all the parameters in this equation. so there is a mistake because the current IS is not IS but IP, that is the forces is dependent on the peak of the current. Sorry, by the way, we need ideas and not symbols. A is the distance between the two cables. If I have this arrangement, this equation provides everything. But typically, cables are laid down also with other arrangement, and so I can calculate on the basis of this basic equation the actual forces for other arrangements, as well as the forces on the covers and on clamps, leader tapes, and so on. The forces for tapes and so on are problems for the cable manufacturer, but if the cable is important, I have to specify this in my datasheet. The other issues are more related to the cable installation. So we can calculate on the basis of the basic equation these other forces, using two factors, alpha and beta, as shown in this equation, and alpha and beta are provided in this table for various arrangement of our cable. With alpha, I can evaluate the forces between the cable, the radial forces, and with beta I can calculate the tangential forces useful to calculate stresses on, for example, on tapes. So we are at the end of this lesson. We provided the basic of short circuit useful and necessary to evaluate the stresses on cables in case of short circuit. This kind of stresses are related mainly to thermal stresses and mechanical stresses. A proper sizing of the cable as to